Hello. My name is Sandhya Sanjana. I was born in Bombay. And I'm sorry, I'm not going to call it Mumbai. I mean, the reason why the name has been changed to Mumbai was a long time ago. And I'm still sticking to my guns and I'm going to call it Bombay for the rest of my life. So please forgive me. So I'm not going to call this Bombay Local, that I'm not going to do. But anyway, so I was born in Bombay a long time ago. And I'm born in a tiny little ethnic group called the Saraswats. I don't know if some of you might have heard of them. But there are a lot of the kids are usually, I mean the girls, if they, I don't know what happens these days because many Saraswats don't marry Saraswats. And you know, the community is really dwindling and becoming, I'm also guilty. I married a Sanjana and produced two, not entirely Saraswat's kids, but we did something else though, which was quite wonderful. So, in that colony, everybody, you know, the radios were playing all the time, and you heard Vivid Bharti, and you heard classical music, and all, you also heard A Date With You on Saturdays, where they played all these pop songs and stuff. So I grew up listening to all of this stuff, and I, as I said in that little thing that I did, the blog, that I think I started like singing around the same time as I started to talk, you know. So singing became just an expression of another way of expressing myself. And my mother used to sing on the radio in Dharwad. My dad was very fond of singing. Chidanand Nagarkar, who's like a Saraswat singer, you know, he was like very fond of his singing. And sometimes he would drink a lot of alcohol and sing to us, and we didn't like that. But apart from that, yeah, so I guess, I mean, got to give something to genetics. So I think, yeah, I was born in a family of music, so I grew up listening and singing it. So I was singing a lot of Bollywood songs, of course, because they were playing played on Vivid Bharati and all of that stuff. And yeah, well, this was until I was five. And then at five, I was transplanted from Bombay to Delhi, which I'm not going to call Delhi either. And so over there, I was raised by my uncle, my Mamaji, who we were very few Konkani people in Delhi. I mean, we were very few people in the world to start with. But in Delhi, we were even a smaller group. So in order to keep them together, my uncle used to have this thing called the Konkani Association. So all the Konkanis were invited. Like, the Konkanis have subsects of Chitrapur Saraswats and Kaut Saraswats, etc. But luckily, the Konkani Association included all of them, you know. So they would all come together, you know, regularly, like four times a year, whatever, and do different kinds of things. Like, they would have Konkani plays, or they would have, no, this wasn't necessarily a Konkani, you know, propagating thing. It was just to bring the Konkanis together. So there was folk music evening when I would learn a Gujarati song, and I've learned Rabindranath Tagore as well. So I do sing him in, which I could have done now. There was just not enough time to all prepare all of that stuff. But, yeah, so we did all of that. Then we also did Shakespeare, and we did, you know, I remember that Solid Yukti that I did, you know. Anyway, so I did lots of different things. So I was on stage from a very young age, and that's why singing, you know, comes quite naturally, and I don't really have butterflies and stage fright like a lot of other people do, I suppose, which is great, because I can't wait to get on stage and start singing, you know. But I normally don't even wait to get on stage to start singing, because a little while ago we were waiting for all of you to show up, and then Suresh starts playing me a set of chords, which I've never heard before. He says, why don't you sing on that? And I started singing, and we just made up a melody. You know, this is how it works. So, music really, I mean, as we all know, is a universal language. It goes through, you don't have to know each other's language to be able to, you know, communicate. You can communicate all kinds of emotions through it, and the most beautiful thing about it is that it reaches everybody, especially rhythm, right? I mean, you have some song, I don't know, it's in Swahili or in, you know, on Svenska or whatever, but it has a beat and everybody's tapping their foot to it, you know, so the body reacts to it, right? And then, I mean, when the body reacts to the rhythm, and the mind and the spirit react to the melodies and the harmonies. So I haven't met until now a single person who says, I hate music. I met somebody who had met somebody who said they hated music, but I'm glad I never met that person. Because I don't think, I mean, everybody loves music. Maybe they say, I like music, but mostly people love music, don't they? So, and that's that. It's so great that, you know, I mean, in the end, I think we talk about creativity. I think we're all different creative artists in our own different fields, but in the end, it's like a force. It's like something that you tap into, you know, and the whole point is to make yourself a great vehicle for that force to flow through, you know. And the more and more you, like, you do riyaz, then your voice can do that stuff better, you know. And when you're doing all those very complicated tans, you don't falter, you know. But in the end, it's like it's a spirit that flows through you. And I only can keep, you know, keep going on and on saying how grateful that I am that, you know, Ma Saraswati has decided to, you know, descend through me, through my vocal cords, whatever, you know. It's just, it's a great privilege and an honor. And I can never be thankful enough for that, you know. So, anyway, so I go to Delhi and start listening to all kinds of pop songs and stuff. And the unfortunate thing is, because I'm kind of on tour here and I'm going back in a couple of days, I was hoping to show you a bunch of videos and photographs and stuff to, you know, corroborate what I'm talking about, but I found out that there's no Wi-Fi here. If there was, I could have streamed some videos and stuff anyway, but if you want to know, I can tell you after the thing about what you can find, etc. Anyway, so I formed my band with my mama's son, who played the mandolin, and there was another a guy called Jerry who played the guitar. There was a guy called Benji who played the bongos, and there was my neighbor Anand who played the spoons, right? So with this little band, I was singing all these little pop songs like "How much is that dog in the way?" and stuff like that. Yeah, I mean, and I didn't feel embarrassed because I was only 5 years old, you know. So, and I did like Connie Francis tunes and Pat Boone tunes. I don't know if you guys have ever heard of those people, but anyway, this is. So I grew up doing all of that stuff, right? And that's at a certain point of time, there's Pandit Dinkar Kaikini who's passed on now. And he's also Konkani. So he told my uncle, like, she's got this voice and you shouldn't be just letting her do what she's doing. You should actually get her into classical singing. But in the meanwhile, what had happened was that I had this wonderful, well, we all stick to each other, you know, the Konkanis, especially if you're not in Bombay, you know, you're somewhere else. So there was this amazing woman called Maitraini Munkur, who was an old lady who had gathered, like, bhajans, you know, like, from Hindi, Marathi, whatever, Kannada, you know, and so many different things. And what she had an amazing way of teaching music. So what she did was, I would go to play with her grandchildren, who were my buddies, right? But the deal was that I had to learn one song before I could go out and play, you know. And the other part of it was that she would, like, tune each bhajan to a classical rag, you know. So there was one bhajan which would be in Teentar and it would be tuned in Yaman. So I would learn it very easily without having to go through all the alaps and tans and all, because I was young. And then as I grew older, like, oh, that's Yaman, you know, so you recognize it. So it's a very easy sort of a bridge to let kids, you know, get familiar with a more serious kind of music. So this is, I mean, so I'm lucky, am I not? So I learned all of this stuff. And then finally I started maybe at the age of 10 or so. There was a wonderful singer from the Kirana Gharana called Sita Hirve, who was also Konkani, of course. And I started learning Khyal from her for a little while. Then I came to Bombay. Then I went to the Bharati Vidya Bhavan and I studied over there as well. And then Dinkar Kaikini Ji was there and Shashikala's wife was there later on. And that's where I got my, you know, basic training. And then on and off, I've had, like, you know, some lessons, some rags being taught to me by all kinds of Guruji, and my final Guruji was Pandit Govind Prasad Jaipurwale, who I think is, like, to me, until now, one of the finest classical singers. Because let me tell you how I discovered him. There was this concert, Rang Bhavan was still open. Please, yeah, open that again, please. And there was a full moon night, you know, and then a friend of ours called Shekhar Borkar, who's a wonderful sarod player. He and my husband Diksha, who plays many other things, I'll come to him later. So the three of us went to hear Govind Prasadji, and we were sitting there, the moon was up, and he sang, you know, this, what was it, night? Chayanat, I think he sang. And it was like, it was not just a rag, and it was not just the atmosphere, but it was just his joy, you know, of singing, you know. I mean, as I was saying, you know, like, we had instruments and this music's coming through, but he was so overjoyed, you know, to be this instrument, you know. You could just see that joy radiating from his face. And I said, this I want to learn from him, you know. And somebody said, no way, you know, he's, like, really very famous and, you know, whatever. I said, I'm going to go and learn from him. And then I found out a way to get to him. He used to come to somebody's house in Kulaba. And then I prepared a rag and I went and sang to him. And I said, sure, I'll teach you, you know. Anyway, so this is how it's been. And I've been lucky that a lot of different people have taught me a lot of things. But okay, then I'm not a Gharanedar person, you know. So I'm not like Kirana or Gwalior or Agra. No, I'm like a paria as it comes, you know, with classical music, I guess. But I don't consider that a bad thing, essentially, because each gharana has different kind of styles and different kinds of compositions and things, you know, so it's a very rich palette. And since I'm, okay, so I did sing classical singing, you know, with my husband who played tabla. He used to play the piano when I met him, and he played the blues, and I felt totally like crazily in love with him, and so that's how it started. But the thing is, he was also learning bansuri from a teacher called Pandit Dilkant Mishra, who could teach singing and bansuri. And but he said to Dinsha, he said, if you want to play with Sandhya, and if that's, you know, there's, then if you play flute, you're not going to be able to do it in the classical world, because you could usually either play sarangi, you know, or harmonium, because those are the traditional accompanying instruments. And if you play flute, you're not going to be able to play with her. And he really wanted to play with me, so he switched to tabla, actually, you know. So that's how we were performing for a long, long time. But in the, okay, so this was happening, in the meanwhile, what happened? Okay, so at a certain point of time, there was, I don't know, have you heard of this man called Budi Sirvai? He used to be this Parsi gentleman who was a band leader, you know, from the era, you know, those wonderful old eras of bands and band leaders. So he was a Parsi gentleman who played the accordion, and I suppose he played the piano too. But he would like, because he was so popular, he was number one, you know, in that whole pile. And he would get like Nav Jodhs, you know, for Christmas and whatever, all the gigs he would get. I mean, the best paid ones. But of course, I mean, if he had five gigs on one night, he couldn't be at all five, right? So what he would do is to make five bands, or pick up five bands that existed, and then send them off to each of the gigs. And then, and they were all supposed to be Goody Sirvai's band. And then he would show up at one gig, play two tunes on his accordion, okay, pack up his thing, go to the next one, and he would do the rounds, and he would take all the money and give us half of it, you know.
Okay.
But okay, so this is how bad leaders work. I think they work like that the world over anyway, you know. But I mean, but it was funny that happened, and because these guys from Hyderabad, and their name was, it's a really cute name. The name is Genuine Spares.
Yeah, I know. Yeah,
you know. Okay, so these two brothers, right? So they came around and they wanted, actually they tried to play organ with them, but something, I don't know when, what happened, etc. Suddenly they didn't want the organ, but they wanted me to. They wanted a front singer, you know, singer. So I'd sung a little bit here, and of course, I mean, not sung with a band like that. So I said, yeah, please, let's do it. So I learned up a whole bunch of different rock songs and funk songs and things, songs that were popular those days, including Rock Your Baby. Remember that song? I learned all these songs and I sang them with this band. And we did a gig in the Taj, you know, and we did one in the Oberoi, and we did some other gigs. And I got paid 500 rupees for a gig. And I said, man. And by that time, I studied... At college, I studied English literature and psychology, and then I was going to go into the writing field somehow, you know, be a journalist or a copywriter, whatever. But I did end up being a copywriter for a little while in an agency called Ayers Advertising, which closed very soon after I joined it. I hope it wasn't anything to do with me. But well, my boss, Neville Gomes, he thought that I had some potential in the advertising world. And he didn't want me, you know, to not have a job. So he put me in this company called Ahmed Oil Mills, which is, you know, they used to service their account, and they used to make Parachute and Postman Oil and all of those things. Yeah. So I joined them for a little while. But then when this job came along, you know, of singing with them, you know, then I said, I'm never going to go back to sitting in this boring office, you know, like putting out ads and cutting them and pasting them. You know, this is really not my thing at all. And then Goody was kind enough. He said, oh, since, you know, and he really apparently had also a talent for Western music, you know, because people who heard it, they did like it a lot, you know. So Goody was like, somehow he liked what he saw. So he said, hey, you live at Pond Cuff Parade, you know, there's at the President Hotel, there's a chap called Emiliano De Cruz, who's the band leader over there. And I just heard that his singer and bass player, or some two musicians, but the singer generally has left. She got married and she's starting off on her own. So he has a vacancy. So, you know, hey, this is your chance. You know, I said, okay. So I go up to the president, I meet Emiliano, I said to him, I heard you have a, you know, vacancy, you know. So he says, yeah, man, come and sing, man. I said, okay, let's do it. So, you know, I knew the popular songs because I'd just done them with the other band, right? So I sang a few songs. He said, from today only you start. And this is how it's been somehow. And then from there I went to Delhi. And then I auditioned in the Ashoka Hotel because Dilsha had gone to Delhi by then. And I definitely wanted to, you know, to be singing again. And so I went to the supper club, and there was a guy called Seth Roberts and his band. And then there was a Mr. Jaspar who came, who was an entertainment manager, you know. And he came and auditioned me and said, you start from today, you know, like straight away. Which is great, isn't it? I mean, I've been lucky with those kind of things. So I did.
Because
so,
also you're very brilliant.
Excuse me?
You're very brilliant.
Oh, thank you, thank you. She's my, we have a mutual admiration society, by the way. So, anyway, so the fact is, yeah, the nightclub deal, I don't know how it may have changed over the years, but those years in the 70s when we were doing it, there was a format. You'd have three sets maybe, and the first set was usually when people were dining, etc. So they didn't want to be like, you know, roused up or whatever. So we would play like a 145 minute set of jazz standards. So of course, if I had to sing in nightclubs, that's one thing I hadn't done yet, you know. I listened to jazz and loved it. And then of course, when I was like forced to sing it, I had some friends in Colaba. In fact, Brass Gonzalez's wife, yeah, Yvonne, well, they're a family of musicians actually. Their dad was Chick Chocolate, was a trumpet player, very renowned, you know. And Yvonne married Brass, and Ursula married Johnny. And so they all, and Kitu married Steve, so they're all in, all singers, all in the music. And they were so kind. I mean, I just loved that, all this kind stuff that came my way. So they said, you're going to be singing these standards, so you're going to need some help. So they gave me a stack of records, you know, 33 and one-third RPM records, like, of Ella Fitzgerald, Sarah Vaughan, you know, and all these, and I took them home and I would listen to them, learn the songs, then learn how they scattered through the changes, and this is how, this was my jazz education. But actually, you don't need much more than that. I mean, so I do sing like jazz standards once in a while for fun. I don't do that anymore because I pretty much try and do my own stuff. But when I do that, I don't know that this is D minor 7th and that's F major 9th or whatever. I don't know what the names of the chords are, but I can hear them, you know. And because of our Indian classical training, our ears are completely, brilliantly trained, you know. So we don't even write stuff down. I mean, how can you write like, you know, a harkat which goes, how do you write that? You know, you can't write it. So you don't write it, you learn it from your Guruji and you store it in your brain. So it's a different way of learning, you know. So this is how I learned all the scat solos of Ella or whatever, and that became part of my, you know, my education as well. So this is what we did. I was in Goa not so long ago, and I met somebody. He said, Sandhya, that's you, isn't it? I said, yes. So he said, I'm Blue Hilt. So we had the last job that we, well, the second last job we did was, my husband and I, was in a place called Trinkas in Calcutta. So, and across kind of like, on the same street, on Park Street, there was another club called Blue Fox, where at that moment, the wonder band of India, which is Louis Banks, Brass Gonzalez, Carlton Kitto, Blue Hilt on the bass, and Pan Crane. I mean, seriously, you know, I mean, the cream, the creme de la creme. So they were all there, and it was amazing. Again, as I said, people had time for each other, they were kind to each other, they liked to share and, you know, inform and educate other people, which I find really missing all over the world because people are just sitting in their cell phones. Anyway, so what happened was then on certain Sunday, so Louis would organize these kind of jazz evenings, soirees, where like people are invited to come from all over and join in, like people from different bands, you know, not just his band. And so we would go and rehearse and we would learn new things, you know, in that way. And on certain Sundays, like Pam would invite us to her place. And she would like make a pepper water and jalfrezi. I used to eat meat that time, but I don't anymore. So there was a beautiful Sunday lunch. And after that, we would sit and listen to records, you know. And that's when I first heard about this incredible jazz diva called Betty Carter. I'll come to her later. I mean, there's so many stories about. So, and Pam had, she was Pam's hero, so she had really we've really taken a lot from her style maybe and whatever. So she really thought, well, let me just tell the story right now since I'm at it. So much later, cut to like 1997, when the teacher's whiskey had become one of the sponsors of the jazz festivals, etc. And there was somebody over there, and he put Dinsha and me in charge of some of the stuff. And Betty Carter was cool. So I said, really? Then please, can I give a chaperone? And yes. So I had to. Well, one of the things on a rider was to go and to fetch her in a limousine, because she's an old-fashioned diva. She doesn't live anymore. That was a long time ago. So and then there was a little car for her trio, and she had to be in the limousine. So you have to honor the wishes of a great like this. So we hired a limo, and it was parked outside my building, and my son had a quick photo taken with it. So went to the airport, and of course the streets are so narrow, you can hardly turn with that, and people don't park anywhere, So she saw the wisdom of what I was trying to tell her. I don't think it's a good idea to have a limousine in Mumbai. So we got her a smaller car anyway. And so yeah, I was her chaperone, and I got to see her at most quarters, and it was just it's amazing, it's like you're there with Pandit Vilayat Khan. Amusad Vilayat Khan or Ravi Shankar, if you're hanging with them, it's a different thing, than seeing them on stage, isn't it? So anyway, and then when that happened, I asked for a special favor, which was, can Pam please have an audience with me? And she did. And I'm sure, I never met her later on to find out whether her socks got blown off or not, but I'm sure they were, So I felt, so one kind thing, you deserve another, I guess, So this is what
the one kind thing attracts.
Attracts another, yeah. So the jazz bits were already happening. The Indian stuff was already happening, and Dinsha had also, he studied classical piano, and he played the blues and some jazz, and he also had been studying tabla now, so that he could accompany me. But then we had one awful instance in when we were playing in the supper club in New Delhi in 1977. It was like a band which we thought, we picked some really nice people and we were going to play great music and stuff. But there was some sort of ego clash somehow, whatever. The guy wasn't getting his thing on time. And all I did was say, look, it's not there, it's here. Because people are dancing on the floor, you don't want to make a mistake. He got annoyed and he said, who do you think you are? You're only the singer. And he just walked off stage, and then the drummer threw his sticks and he walked off stage. And it's like one of the most embarrassing things that's ever happened to me, But from every bad thing, a good thing comes, right? And Dinsha is like, he has always been like, I'm an idealist, but he's more of an idealist than I am. And he said, we're never going to work in nightclubs again. It's really awful because it's, people are here only to make money, and they don't care about the music, whatever. We're never going to play anybody else's music. And sure enough, that's what transpired. And the whole point is, I think this is an inspiration that I got from him, which is, in the end, if you call yourself a musician, when you're growing up, you do covers, you play Dire Straits, you play Bob Dylan, whatever, makes your thing turn, But in the end, finally, when you settle down, you have to speak your own language. Who are you as a musician? If you're going to sing somebody an Elvis Presley song or whatever, what relevance has it got to your time and your life and what you're trying to say through your music? So, and I completely agree with that. And I pretty much sing only original stuff. When I say original, I've taken some tunes, because we have such a rich history of poetry, and saint poetry, so many of Meera and Kabir and, all of these wonderful poets who wrote amazing, lyrical poetry. And then I take those and put my own tunes to it sometimes, and then put it so that a band can play it, Then, I can't say it's entirely original. The lyrics are taken from somewhere else. Sometimes I also corroborate, add to them by putting some additional English lyrics or something, But I do things with it. I don't just... And of late, a few years ago, I've started also going back to singing some of my favorite jazz standards, but I never sing the lyrics in English. I put lyrics in Hindi, or I just do with those, Indian gnome tone stuff and whatever. And then it's my take on it, That's what I do, really. because I have something to say. So I'm not going to say something which somebody else has said. So this is one thing that Dinsha really encouraged people in Bombay to do. And there was a band rock machine, you know, they were playing other people's stuff, and then they changed their name to, and then they took a tabla, and then they started writing more original stuff. And so I'm really happy that, you know, while we lived in Bombay, we had a place in Gulistan at Kafferade where we had a soundproof room, and which was actually a working recording studio where we recorded, you know, commercial stuff because you need that. But we were really encouraged every band that was around with us to come around and play every day. And often we'd record it, and that's really the test, because you've jammed, you played a new tune, whatever, and you think you've done really well, you know, and then you play back, oh, no, not that, you know. You think, I shouldn't have done, and then you learn from your mistakes what you shouldn't be playing. So this was another very good thing that we did on a regular basis. So actually I'm really, really happy that with the last version of that we had of Divya had Paresh Kamath, who's a fine guitar player, and Naresh Kamath, who's his brother, who plays bass, and Kurt Peters, who's a wonderful drummer, and this was, and Dinsha and I, this was our last version of it, and then Sarva Ganesh would come and sometimes play Ganjira with us. And then now these guys have gone on to join Kailasa, which I respect a lot, and I think it's one of the finest bands that's come out of India, because they're playing original music, and it's accessible, and yet it's not dumb, you know. It's really like the perfect kind of music that anybody could be making, you know, in this particular context. And I'm so happy that they're playing with them, you know, and doing really well, you know. So yeah, at some point, you know, we started writing tunes, Dinsha and I, where we were combining the influences coming from, you know, jazz and rock. Basically, I think, yeah, when the contributions went this way. Dinsha, having studied tabla, you know, he has a very strong rhythmic bass. And of course, having studied classical music, he would do the harmonic bits. But I'm like the melody queen, you know. So I would always write the tunes that would fit on those harmonic changes. So I don't have any material from... I think it's time for you to listen to something, right? So I play you something to get you an idea of what happened. Okay, so I was telling you about how I borrow from, you know, the traditions of Indian saint poets. So this one was called Purandaradas, and he's from Karnataka, I guess. So he writes in Kannada. And this song, Bhagyada Lakshmi Varama, has been sung by many people in different ways, also been sung to Joshi in a different rag though. And I put, along with my guitar player, we made a sort of a Africanish version of it. I mean, go figure.
Kankan kaiya tirukuta bare
At that point, we were living up in the north in a really remote place where people were really not very friendly and there were hardly any musicians. So I said, what's going to happen? So he said, at this point of time, there's two things that are happening on the net. One is a lot of pornography, and the other thing is lots of MP3s. So there was actually a website called mp3.com, and it was like the predecessor of MySpace, which like has slowly become Facebook. So mp3.com was where people who didn't have record deals could upload their very eclectic and fun music, which didn't have to be commercial or dumbed down, and they could play it, and it was a community, so other musicians could hear you and get to know you and interact. So I put up some of my tunes over there, and I forgot one little really wonderful bit which I really should say before I go to coming to Europe. So in 1987, Divya had an opportunity to go to stay in Amsterdam and keep that as a base for 3 months, and then travel around and play in Sweden, Norway, Germany, and you know, in countries all around. So our base was Amsterdam. That's when I actually first lived there for 3 months, and I fell in love with it. So I had a dream one day of wanting to come and live there. You know, they say, what would you dream for? You know, so it did come true a few years down the line. But also in 87, we had gone and played for this festival in Poland called the Jazz Jamboree, which apparently still exists. It's one of the oldest running jazz festivals. So they call all kinds of people. They have famous people and not so famous people. So we were the not so famous ones in a smaller little hall. And on the big hall, and since we were staying there for the whole festival and we could hear everybody else, we went and heard this wonderful musician called Alice Coltrane, who's the wife of John Coltrane. And she plays the harp and piano, and she had an amazing band. And when I heard her, I'm getting goosebumps thinking back about it so long, after so long. But she has, yeah, she's another person who like considers music, you know, like a way of divine expression. So so she went and heard her, and then went backstage, was courageous enough to like give her a copy of my music and said, I love what you did and please listen to this. It was a cassette those days, and said, please listen to this, if you like it, we're playing tomorrow, I'd like you to come and see us. I didn't know what to expect, but guess what, she was there, and she actually came and listened, and after the concert she came and said something absolutely wonderful. I was telling him, Suresh, on the way here, she said, you know, it's lovely what you're doing, the bridge between kind of jazz and Indian music, and you keep doing what you're doing, and that'll be your contribution to jazz, she said. And I said, thank you, you know. So, well, she's invited me often to the LA to play over there with Divya, and then I did a solo gig with her as well at the John Coltrane Festival. But she showed how, well, not only music, but the spiritual music can be combined, you know. And if you ever get a chance to, like, please look for her music on the net, please do. Her name is Alice Coltrane Turiya Sangeeta Nanda. That's her full name, because she also was like some sort of guru, and she has had an ashram in Los Angeles. And what she did was, because she was like a devout bhakt of Sathya Sai Baba, so she had picked up all the you know, the smarans and the kirtan things that they do in Puttaparthi. So she took those, the lyrics of those, and then they set them to gospel music, which the blacks do very well. And it's like, I mean, really, it's like thrilling music. And I mean, it's unfortunate I couldn't really download any of it. I looked around, but I couldn't. So she would, you know, for 1 hour she would like have a discourse in her ashram in LA. And after she did that, she'd sit on her organ and start playing these gospel-y kind of chords. And the whole congregation would start, and they would sing Hindu chants with the gospel tunes and in harmonies. So, you know, combining all kinds of beautiful traditions come together, and it was really absolutely wonderful. So this was another thing that, you know, has really enriched my life. Okay, so I was saying, so mp3.com, I put some of my tunes up there, and I was really surprised, and many people really said, what is this? Because, you know, I mean, it, back in 1999, what I do was far more, you know, like strange or exotic, especially in Europe. So a lot of them wanted to collaborate with me. And this is where I'm talking about the walking the musical bridge. And it's just the most thrilling thing that, for me, in my life, because I'm not a purist, as you might have gathered, you know. So what I did was, finally, you know, to make this like an experiment, let's try this thing, you know. So I recorded two simple taranas that I wrote. One was in, because tarana also doesn't have lyrics, it's all noam tom, so it's rhythmical, so everybody, you don't have to really, like, you know, get into that. So I wrote two simple ones, one in 100 beats per minute, one in 100, the same one I did in 100 and 120 beats per minute, because those are popularly liked, you know, tempi, you know, for songs. And then one was in Madhuvanti and one was in Savan. So I recorded these. I mean, I'd had the Tanpura playing, of course, when I was recording them, but it was only in my headphones. So it was just a voice singing with no reverb, nothing, singing the tarana, singing a few tans, whatever, singing the tarana, whatever, a little alap in the beginning. And I recorded this whole thing, and I didn't even put the tabla on it, basically. So this I did, and I put them up on a special section on my website. And whoever wanted to collaborate with me, I would listen to their music if I thought it was, you know, I liked it. Then I'd let them, gave them the, you know, the access to those recorded taranas, and they could download them and do whatever they liked with them. And I call it the Tarana Project. I wish I could have brought you some of that stuff too, but maybe you can, I don't know if you can find it anymore, because mp3.com doesn't exist anymore. So they took these things and they made different things out of it. The one was a really rocky one, you know, he had like that kind of rhythm on it. You know, there was another one which he made into a bossa nova, and he called it Tarana Bossa. Just thrilling and beautiful. And then another one made like with dub, you know, dub music, like reggae dub, that kind of stuff. Proper dub with one of my tunes, you know. So it just shows that, you know, like the versatility, you know, and the richness of Indian music, that it can pretty much combine with anything. And that's the legacy that I've had, you know. So music becomes really like a conversation. As I was saying, Suresh, you know, we have to sing a few songs with him. Come on. that's what happens when you sit over there. You know? It's your fault. Okay. I'm going to sing you a song. Which one should you do first? Kash? Okay. This is a song that I wrote about longing. Because my husband works in London and I live in Amsterdam, and I only get to see him on the weekends. So all of you will understand the lyrics much better than my European audiences. Yeah? Okay. It's called Kash. काश कि मैं एक बादल हूँ मैं तुझ पे ही बरसूं काश कि हम नजदीक थे मैं तुझ पे ना तरसूं काश कि हम पंछी उड़े सारे आसमान में आकाश ही इतना बड़ा मेरे प्यार को धरे मन एक पंछी यूं उड़े सपनों में हम ना जुड़े काश कि मैं एक फूल हूँ अब तेरे आंगन में काश कि मैं एक बादल हूँ मैं तुझ पे ही बरसूं काश कि हम नजदीक थे मैं तुझ पे ना तरसूं काश कि हम पंछी उड़े सारे आसमान में आकाश ही इतना बड़ा मेरे प्यार को धरे मन एक पंछी यूं उड़े सपनों में हम ना जुड़े काश कि मैं एक फूल हूँ अब तेरे आंगन में दिया बराबर अभिया Tia barabar abhi hai Tia barabar abhi hai Tia barabar abhi Thank you. Barabarabit. Yeah. Thank you. We don't have too much time. Maybe I should just sing one more song or something. Yeah.
Please,
we have time. We have time for him. Yeah. Thank you, Suresh. Suresh Mendoza, he worked as an engineer with us in our studio, and he has a band of his own called Sur. Please check his music out here. Okay, so let me tell you a few more things very quickly and to sum this all up. So I've done collaborations with lots of different people, and I'm thinking of which is the most interesting, because I had about five or six. We don't have time. This is where I, okay, so I met this, like I met people on empathy.com, that died, I think, and then they turned into MySpace. And again, the same thing, we'd have communities of musicians who played similar kind of music, would say, hey, let's do something together. So this guy lives in Paris, and we'd gone to Paris for my birthday to watch this amazing production called Monkey, which is this rock Chinese opera. And after it, he came and he said, let's go, you know, and we'll make some music together. So we made this piece. It's called Sehra. I just come back from Morocco, in a place called Layoun, where it's the Western Sahara, where the sea and the desert meet, which is kind of unique. So this song had something to do with that.
Place where the desert meets the sea.
Is also a sample. So, I mean, you can make very authentic sounding music, you know, without sounding electronic, you know what I mean? And now I'm part of his band. In fact, when I go back on the 9th or the 11th, I have a gig in Paris where it's like the music is all done and it's put on the computer or on a program which musicians love. It's called Ableton Live, which you can put on the stuff, but it doesn't have to be rigid. If I want to extend a solo a little bit, they can keep it, you know. So it's a very flexible program which is used for live performance. So all the parts are on it. Plus we have a keyboard player from Madagascar who plays with us live. And we have an amazing percussion player from Brazil called Carneiro who plays percussion with us. And we have the guy on the computer, of course, he puts in a few sounds and a few effects and stuff. And Pierre, you know, the guy, my friend, who plays the saxophone, the silver flute, he plays a little bansuri, he plays a little ney also. He's also learned a little bit of dudu, he's amazing. He plays double bass, but he doesn't play it with the band. And he also, yeah, and he plays a oud as well. So it really gives a huge, like, palette of colors, you know, to add to the music. So the band's called Milo Project, you might want to look it up somewhere. And it's, he calls it Electro World Jazz, you know, understand? M-A-I-D-O Project, yeah. And, I sing with them, so yeah. I'm hoping to bring them here. You know. I think it worked very well, didn't it? Yeah. So anyway, it's lots of things to talk about, you know, and a lot of people I met, and you know, it's just, life is this journey, it doesn't stop. I keep meeting wonderful people and making music with them. But one of the things that I did talk about in that open letter that I talked about was that, you know, I don't think there's hardly any emphasis. I don't know how maybe things have changed since I've gone. I've been away for 15 years. But when I was growing up, and especially when my kids were growing up, they had to go to school with huge, you know, satchels on their back, and they had to have extra tuitions, etc. I said, this is not the life I want to bring up my kids in, you know. So I homeschooled them. They never stepped into a school ever. And I, you know, I taught them the, you know, the reading and the writing and the arithmetic and geography and history, by the way, and lots of things. And they studied, and they were, the emphasis was really on music and other things, because then a typical day would find us like having breakfast together, and then my daughter would go and start practicing the classical piano on the grand piano in the living room. My son would go into the control room and play, do his drum practice, and in the singer's booth, I would be sitting there doing my classical riyaz. So this is how it happened. And then after lunch, we'd sit down and do the curricular studies, you know. So, and my daughter also studied some ballet and some speech and drama, and she was a very good actress. She's also, then finally they all went to America, and then they went to regular college as well, and then they did pretty well over there. So I must have done a pretty decent job then. But well, they did get a huge musical education, and my daughter's not really playing so much music, but she's styling things, clothes and looks for magazines, etc., in Hollywood, which is also a creative field. And my son, well, he does other things, but he also makes this music, which is a genre called chill out, and I sing with him, and I have lots of fun because there's a lot of great stuff out there. I mean, it's and not one tune sounds like the other. Everything's different, and there's all kinds of different ideas, and so and I'm very happy that you know, I could actually take this bold step of teaching. I don't think at that time anybody else had done that. I think maybe more people are doing it. In fact, just now I was in Bangalore recording with this amazing singer who was from a band called Human Bondage, which was well known amongst our generation. Her name is Radha Thomas, and she's written some blues songs, and you know, she thought that since I improvise, and you know, it's basically a two-woman group, so she sings the songs and I improvise on it, or sometimes I do corner pole instead of the beats, you know, to keep the rhythm going. And we had a piano player, but so the story goes back to how this boy is 19 years old. His name is Ron Cha. I mean, that's his musical name, Ronajit Cha something. And he is 19 years old, and he plays the piano like a dream. And we got him down from Guwahati, you know, to play with us. And I said, how did you manage? So he says, I've been homeschooled too. So he did school when he up to a certain point, and then when things started lightening up, and you know, I think that's one way to do it, you know, because in normal schools, almost kill your creativity, don't they? They just make you boring and dull and hate school, in fact, you know. I was lucky that I went to a school where art and music, etc., were quite encouraged. I went to school in Delhi. It was an Air Force school, but, you know, we had art classes out in the open, you know. So it creates a different kind of atmosphere, but it's not like that anymore. So I'm hoping that some young people over here will go back encouraged and, you know, teach their children some more music and whatever, you know, some find out the creative potential in them and encourage it, you know, because if you don't actively do it, it's not going to happen on its own. And it's our responsibility as parents. I mean, what they do with it when they grow up, it's another, you know, it's their choice, but at least we can give them a strong, you know, a base in that, you know. And I think, I'm very happy that I did that for my kids, really. So that was another part of the thing, and I could go on and on until tomorrow, but we're going to end with a song that I, one of the early songs that I wrote. I've been born a Hindu, as you figured out, you know, Chitrapur Saraswat, and I've been a practicing Buddhist for the last 35 years. So, Acharnam Yo Rengi Kyo. And the central philosophy of Hinduism and Buddhism is the theory of karma, which, you know, it's the central thing. So I'm putting ideas about Hindu ideas about karma and Japanese ideas about karma all rolled up into this song. So that's my last one. They keep an account a very thought word indeed. He'd sleeping and waking hour. The sum total of all the causes she makes give her life direction and power. भागो क्रोध को त्यागो सद्धर्म की जय जय सद्भाव जय जय सत् शब्द जय जय सत्कर्म की जय जय झूठ से भागो क्रोध को त्यागो सद्धर्म Yatri and one's called Taranga, and I've also sung live with him, so that was one band, but I don't sing with him anymore. And there was a band of somebody called Praful that he knows. He combines Brazilian and Indian music, and I've done some stuff with him, but that band doesn't exist anymore. So I've been in different bands. I'm also part of a group called Madras Special, which is actually from the guy, the percussion player from Human Bondage, that's Ramesh Shotam, who lives in Cologne now. So we have this band with an amazing violin player from Hungary, from Budapest, who is called Zoltan Lantos. And that's the band we have, where we do kind of Carnatic-based kind of, you know, loosely songs. And we don't play so much anymore because Ramesh is a hotly sought percussion player who plays all over the world with many different bands. So, to get a band on the road, you have to sit there and make phone calls, send out emails, you know, which he doesn't have time to do. So we're now doing a concert with Madras Special after 2.5 or 3 years. But when I go back home on the 25th, we're playing in a place called Ludwigshafen in Germany, and that'd be fun. And in that performance, we're also doing one set with Madras Specials and one with this classical pianist from Bombay, I forget his name, but it is somebody. And then we're going to do one set where we're going to combine together. So that's where, you know, these bridges keep happening all the time. It's endless, you know, how many variations you can make. Yeah, and I have, like, myself, I sing with Milo Project in Paris. And the funny thing is, some years ago, I said, I really want to go and play in different places. And it's, since I'm not as famous, you know, as it's necessary to be able to take my entire band with me and have them pay, you know, airfares and, you know, staying, etc. But also, not, but that's part of it. But the other part is also that I've played with my band at home, right? So the idea came up, and I was going to Auckland in New Zealand to perform for a friend of mine who's no longer there. And he got some people together, and I played in Auckland for New Year's Day 2014. And when I was going there, a friend of mine over here who's a saxophone player said, if you're going there, why don't you get in touch with Ben Fernandez, who's a piano player from Bombay who lives there now and also does the same combining of Indian music with jazz, and his band is called Rag Time, you know. So and he apparently has been to the studio our place and has been also inspired by Divya. So how lovely. So he his band, you know, so the my new way of working is send my music in MP3 form, and as well as like the sheets, which I don't write, by the way. I mean, if I had to write them, it would take me 5 days to write one song. So I get my musician friends who are very competent to write them out. And then those I put in Dropbox. And then the people who want to combine with me, you know, like play with me, I send that ahead. And then they prepare those songs, you know. And then when we go there, we have one rehearsal and we play. And what's wonderful about all these music, the bands that I've played with, is that they really do their homework, which I'm afraid is not what happens here. So I've tried to do that over here, and I send the music in advance and say, "Acha, parso rehearsal hai, but wo kaun sa gana tha?" You know, that happens a lot. But I must say that this time around, I had better luck. I'm playing at Kalaghoda Festival tomorrow at 9:20, and the band that's backing me is really, they do all their homework, and they already played at Bandra Base last Saturday, and it was lots of fun. So yeah, so it's quite an international band. There's a Dee Wood who plays bass. There's a Japanese, a very young Japanese drummer who plays the tabla as well, who's learning, whose name is Ko Omura. Then we have an Indian guy who's like studied at the Bill Evans Institute in Paris. So he plays piano, and we have a guitar player from Cyprus, would you have it? Wow. Yeah, and he's really very good too. So, yeah, we practiced once, we've done one gig, and we're going to play it tomorrow night. It should be fun. So I have a band in Auckland, I have a band in Santiago in Chile, I have a band in Austin, Texas, which is my best like foreign band actually. You know? And we played this lovely festival called South by Southwest last year, no, in 2014. So it's fun. And then the excitement is that I go there and play with all these different people, and then they bring their own, you know, their own thing to it, and it sounds different each time, and that keeps it exciting, because I mean the same tune done over and over again tends to get pretty boring, you know. So you know, that's the beauty about music, it's all about interpretation. The composition is just a tiny part of it, right? Except in classical, Western classical music.
Sandhya,
do you have any questions?
Sorry.
No, I said, do you have any questions?
Yeah, I had a question, yes. 1997, I remember Betty Carter, two concerts she did here.
Yes.
And fantastic effect. You spent a lot of time with her while she was here.
Yeah.
Tell us something about what she might have said about her music or music in general.
I mean, not that much really. It was just, you know, being there and seeing, you know, the way she carried herself. She carried herself very regally, you know. And my first encounter with Betty was when I saw her, when I first went to New York in 1988, and she was playing in, the Village Vanguard or Sweet Passage, one of those clubs. So we're there like saying, wow, finally I get to see Betty in live, you know, in a live in a club. So we're there, like in time, we're sitting there, sipping our wine or whatever. She's laid by an hour, okay? And her band is playing away young. She always has these young, very hot bands, and they're playing. No sign of Betty. And finally she walks in, you know, she used to always wear these turbans and these flowing, you know, robes and everything. And she walks in and she says, "Ah, I'm late. And the traffic was so terrible on Fifth Avenue," and whatever. And she makes up an entire song to go with what the band was playing, and it all made sense. It all, I mean, she's an improviser, you know. And so this is how, you know, this. And she was kind of singing and humming around. One of the nicest things about her that I must tell you was, my best friend used to smoke a lot, and Betty said, "You're not going to do that anymore, girl," you know, and then she quit. I mean, she was so stern and so regal in the way she spoke to you that if Betty Carter told you not to smoke, you didn't smoke. And I swear to you, she stopped and she hasn't touched a cigarette since then. That's one of my the nicest memories of that time. When with Niranjan, we go to Willingdon Club or, you know, CCI and whatever. And, you know, yeah, she just, I think she was musical in the way she moved and, you know.
Short little woman.
Not that short, yeah.
I
something like that. And then the thing is, so it's the 97 September or something, she must have come. And also Trilok came with his band and Joe's Army and Syndicate, etc. And then I went to Europe in 1998 because I was doing a tour of the German band in Germany. So my husband bought me a ticket to the a season ticket to the North Sea Jazz Festival, which was one of the biggest treats I've ever had. So I went there, and then she was playing, and she remembered me, and it was really nice. But the thing is, I met her, I heard her play, and 3 months later, she had died of cancer. Amazing. I mean, that she was there doing her stuff, and nobody had a clue that she was so ill.
Do you think this kind of what kind of effect do these collaborations between such varying kinds of music have on the audience? Because I remember when I was growing up, there was a whole lot of attempts at fusion music, and they were fairly frowned upon, and they didn't always sound right, even to my completely uneducated ears.
Uh-huh.
But obviously things have changed. There's been so much interaction between musicians, as you just said.
Well, okay, let me just ask you a question back. What did you think of the song Karma, for instance? What did you think of? I mean, how did it affect you? Did you feel that it did, yeah, it worked or it didn't work?
It worked. In the
sense, so in the end, that's a key word. I think that the operative words are, does it work or doesn't it work, you know?
Mm.
And I think anything works when there's integrity behind it, you know? You're not just fusing things because that's popular these days and I'd get highly paid gigs. If that's your intention, don't do it. You know, the whole point is, and the other thing is, which is really important, I think, I was just having a long chat with him before, is that a lot of our the musicians, you know, like when they combine things, I don't see the reason why they do it. I mean, I don't combine it because I want to combine it. I can't help it, you know. When I'm singing, when I'm speaking also, I have like Hindi words coming out. Whatever, that's the way I am, you know. My life is a fusion of many cultures, languages, different things, ideas and stuff. And that's how my music comes out. So I'm not trying to do something. I'm just letting that thing flow through me. And I think when the integrity is there, it works. And it touches. So at this in Auckland when I was playing, I did a set of performances last year. The last one, this woman comes up to me, hugs me and says, "You know, your concert took me all over the world," she said. I said, "What do you mean?" So then I hadn't even thought about it. And then she says to me, I have a song called Ara Teju, which I had written when I was had gone to visit my friends and I was jamming with them. It's an area in Portugal, which is a very beautiful area. And it carries this kind of the sound and the spirit. So she said, "You took me to Arantejo." And then I write a song called Aziza, which is dedicated to a wonderful singer from Azerbaijan called Aziza Mustafa Zadeh. And she's a piano player come singer. And she does these fast passages when she sings like George Benson does, you know, the singing and the guitar thing. She does them piano and voice, you know, and you must check her out too. And so I love her music. I saw her in the North Sea and I wrote a song called Aziza. But it has some Azerbaijani kind of, you know, whatever, my impression of whatever it may be. So she said, you took me to Azerbaijan, and then another song took her, you know, different places. And then I have a song called Change, which is, again, a funny song because it is the bass line I took from this song called Chicken, which is a very famous bass line. That one, you know, that. So I take that, and I've written a Buddhist song on that, actually, about whatever, about change. Nothing's constant in life but change. So there are allusions to different things that have affected me, and I think, yeah, if you can stand behind your music and not cringe when other people listen to it, you know, I think that's a test. You know? I mean, I'm never going to say, I wish Ranjit won't walk in through that door when I'm singing this song, you know what I mean? I'm not going to say that, because I'm proud of what I do, you know, not excessively egoistically, but, you know, I stand behind what I do, because this is me, you know. So I guess that is the truth. And a lot of people don't know the two things that they're combining. Mm. Often, like a lot of jazz musicians in Bombay don't know anything about Indian music. They get one mridangam guy, they get one, you know, guy, and then one drummer's going, it's usually acrobatics, as far as I'm concerned. It's like, how many notes can I put into 1 second? You know, that's the whole point. And if that's the point, I'm out of here. It's really boring, it's been done too often. And there's no heart in it, you know. In the end, you have to do something which makes somebody sing, you know, and happy. It's not about ego and stuff. You know? So, I think the intention behind anything is important. You know? Why are you doing this, you know? I'm doing it because I don't know how to do anything else. You know? Simply that. And a lot of, like, but I was saying, telling him that people come, like, this amazing musician called Carl Clemens that I've had the fortune of playing for, like, over 25 years, maybe by now, or more, actually, a lot more. So he is a saxophone player, like, studied very well at Berkeley, etc. And also played, yeah, so he came to India to learn bansuri from Nityanand Harjipur, you know, who's like Banaral Ghosh's descendant. Yeah. And he comes every year and he sits with his Guruji for hours and learns, you know. He's still, like, you know, polishing up his, he's not finished, you know. He comes here and then he plays with other people. So now when he plays it, he's got the jazz thing and he's got the Indian thing, you know what I mean? Actually, he's one person I know that doesn't combine. He doesn't combine it. That's his prerogative. It's okay, you know. But I mean, if there would be anybody who, like, I would ask to come and sing on some of my songs, I'd ask him, because, okay, he doesn't do it in an obvious way, but, you know, he's got that feeling inside him, you know? So that's what it is, I think. I think the intention, why are you doing this, you know? Is it some sort of self-aggrandizement, or is it really, you know, your heart speaking to people and reaching to them, you know? And you can't fake it, I think. You know? I think it's quite hard, unless you're really a big fan and, you know, you go and listen to anything that somebody churns up.
I have one more question. Sense, and perhaps, I mean, other people can perhaps answer it as well. My sense is that Bombay in the 60s, 70s, etc., there was a lot of space for people to create their own music. Also, like, in the sense of the backing of clubs or, you know, like, or just jazz band, etc. And what I hear from people in the music circuit today in Bombay is that there's not much backing for original work, and I don't know much about it, but I want
actually
to
this I won't be able to really answer in a proper way, because I haven't lived here. I spend at the most a month or two, a year or 2 years, so I'm not really qualified to, but he lives here and you should ask him that question. Yeah.
Actually, now because of YouTube and stuff, you've got all the backing, you can put your music out to the world in like 10 minutes. So
that's the new space.
It's the biggest thing. We don't need record companies to promote our music. We can do it ourselves.
Okay.
You know? And we're going instantly to the world. So it's much better now.
But in that
but
way.
But from the club point of view and band point of view, there's so many venues that is two hard rocks and one blue frog.
Yeah, yeah.
Which pay you like pittance.
Yeah.
You can't play there.
That's so good.
So what do you think has changed? I mean, how did it become a
I think there's lots of festivals, you know.
No, but the festivals are not paying enough. You get just.
As I said, I don't know. I mean, it seems to me every time I come here that there's more venues and there's more festivals and you know, a lot of stuff going on. Sorry.
That seems what. That's the impression I get.
So I thought it's like improving. I thought.
It's a. There's a big monster called Bollywood.
Gobbles up everything inside.
Any festival now, who closed the gate? I think yeah. So, creative stuff and all, a very minuscule percentage of people will really appreciate and really go. Even Blue Frog doesn't, you know, kind of encourage. Now, there's a lot of DJ music, which is
Now I have my pet gripe, okay? I think ever since YouTube, you know, I have Spotify, I played you some stuff from Spotify, I'm on it myself. But what happens is with like music freely available to download or stream, you know, people are not interested in buying music anymore. So what do? I think the only thing you can do is to perform live, you know. And there is enough of that going on in the West. But there are a lot of things going on in India, but according to him, they're not very well paid.
Time for see the ultimately the musician has to play and perform on the stage. It's not the studio anymore, the stage. So ultimately the real good guys who can really play will be able to make money out of it and you know survive. The rest of the guys, like everybody who has a laptop, can make a tune and in fact a computer make it.
Put a few loops together.
Yeah.
That's the problem that we are all facing in the arts. Democratization of arts is going to mean that all kinds of people want to put out all kinds of things, from 2-minute films to 30-second films, 5-second, 10-second little things that you're going to watch on your on your phones. Similarly, music. But then similarly, art. Everything is going to.
I think it's dilution of the arts.
I think
I'm not sure about the dilution of the art.
Oh, I can agree. But I mean, if you had to make a record, you had to be a musician. Okay, that means you would have had to spend many days and many hours and many years. But we call that the busting chops. It means like woodshedding. There are different names, doing riyaz, sadhana, whatever. It's the same thing. You sit with your instrument or your voice for many hours, and you, when you're young, and you, you know, accumulate a lot of techniques and you know stuff, you know, and then you go on stage. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Whereas nowadays, I mean, people don't even sing in tune. They can have autocorrect. You know what I mean?
Autocorrect.
It's awful. It's really. But I must say, there's a lot of
dilution. But this is part of the process, and it just may lead to something else. I don't know. I'm an actress, and every second person and her sister and her maid, everyone feels that I can act.
Yes.
And
do it.
You can. Sure. Sure you can. I can make a little home movie and I can do what I'm doing and I do it right. And it'll be interesting to watch. But it's the sustainability. Will I get it right each time? Will I get it right every time I play any kind of character, not just myself? Etc. Etc. So similarly, it's the musician with riyaz who will get it right every time in studio, on stage,
in the middle of the night, woken up,
So lagega. So this is part of it. There are these two extremes that are going to
and they balance each other out somewhere.
They will. I have a feeling.
Just take one example from the media space. Everything is being broken to pieces. You've reached a point where Two forces on the break side. One force is any of us can write a blog, any of us can write whatever we want. The other force is that the PR industry, which told you what angle to take. Today, you don't have to go to the press or whatever. Anyway, news, anybody doing a program or something newsy can type it out and put it on the computer. So therefore, your in-house PR, your in-house stuff is happening, so that entire value chain is being disrupted. Now, go onto the net. At the end of the day, the curation process earlier used to be done by the fact that you had only so many hours of screen time and only so many pages that you could print. Today, is curation valued? Would you like to only read a few things? At one level, yes. Now, the computer can do dynamic curation for you. It can give you a national perspective on something, a global perspective on something else, and a local perspective of your mohalla, even on your city, if you want that. right? And then you could have a hobby. For example, you might want a curation only on acting. So you'll get that also. Now, that is being, those things are being done by the computer, but at the end of the day, you have X number of hours. Will you value somebody who is going to give you something worth reading?
Correct.
At that point, the new editor will emerge.
Yes.
And also at that point, today it's already happening, long-form journalism and long-form reports are again emerging as something new for which people are willing to pay, not because of the constraint that I have to pay, but I'm willing to pay for long-form.
I need and something to fill my brain.
Brain, I want to think further. In this mess, I want to go further. Now, a new audience will re-emerge from this. Now, it's all very well.
God knows.
There's not a problem here. The problem is, it's all very well to take the long perspective and say, this is the big force happening. But the big force can take 25 years, and in those 25 years, a human being is dead. Career is over.
So it's all up in the air, I think, you know.
Exactly.
Like I was in San Francisco and went to see a charity show put up by lots of different Indian bands. And this what's Rifat? She's a Nazakat Salamat Ali, one of their daughter. She's a fantastic singer. I got to know her later on when I went to San Francisco, and we went and did the Bhangra somewhere.
Okay.
She's really fun. So she was singing in, you know, with her Kavali kind of situation somewhere. All kinds of wonderful bands playing everywhere. Karsh, I met Karsh Kali not so long ago, and I said, remember that show? You know, I really got upset because these were all the warm-up bands. And guess what was the headline of the thing? A DJ called Chebi Sabah. He's no longer with us, okay. He was a person who pioneered, you know, all this world music stuff, but in the end, he's a DJ. You know, he doesn't play a note of music. What he did was got this musician, this one.
That he was talking about.
But yeah. I mean, he's not called a curator though.
Yeah.
They don't call him curator, Chebi Sabah, you know. Mm. So that's what I'm saying. It's kind of really ironic, isn't it?
Look at the way the world curation has changed. How many of us have had used, except those who went to a museum, how many of us had heard the word curator?
Correct.
And look at the way it is being applied all over the place.
Thrown around.
Yeah, words expand or change their meanings.
Yes.
Especially when words, nouns become adjectives, and that's when they
take off.
Yeah.
You'll be the dinosaur, actually.
We're not dead. We'll get dead, but we're not getting it.
No, but even if we're dinosaurs, we're needed for evolution.
Absolutely.
Obviously. But I think in the end, people get the music they deserve, like politicians.
One question. Why the strong connection between Jain and Hindustani? I don't know.
You mean why does it exist in the world?
There's something like here, alike, common.
But they both with improvisation
as well.
I mean, in jazz you have a structure like which is exactly like the bandish.
Mm-hmm.
That's the common thing. Well, in that way they're very similar, and they in another way they're absolutely not similar. Which is Hindustani music is or Carnatic music or any kind of Indian music is modal music. You have one sa and a pa, and it's fixed.
Mm.
It doesn't change.
Mm.
Whereas all Western music is based upon harmony, which means at one point, three notes or two notes or whatever are being played and they keep changing. So it's a completely different approach. And yet, the core is the art of improvisation, you know. You take a song and do things through it, you know, that's what you do. So, and in jazz, of course, you use many other scales and things, and usually in Indian music, you'd use one scale. But it's the intricacy with which you do it, you know, with the feeling with which you do it, all those things, matter a lot.
Well, folk music is improvisational too, isn't it?
Absolutely.
So how come that doesn't get used so much? It's an interesting question. Why Hindustani classical or Carnatic classical?
You have to be here. I don't know why. It just sounds like common base. That's all.
I'm very happy to hear you say that because, I mean, if I go and sing Hindustani, something based, something in a jazz club in New York, they don't think so. I think because in India, we've also been growing up, especially like our generation, you know, the older people have grown up listening to a lot of different things. You know. I mean, look at how many languages we hear, you know. I can speak a smattering of Gujarati, I speak very good Hindi, Marathi and Konkani, you know. So, I mean, our ears are very well trained, I think. So it's more in our, in the Indian psyche, right? I think. I'm not sure.
I did a jugal bandi years back of Didi Bridgewater and Shankar Mahadevan without practicing.
Yeah.
And they sounded fantastic.
But I keep doing that every day.
It's wonderful to hear.
That's what I do. Not for a living, but that's what I do to live. Really. Because I find like doing the same old thing again and again really boring. So, as I said, he just pulled up his
impromptu. You can't plan.
He just did that. He just played a simple chord.
Practice. It just
And I sang with him, you know. And I've never heard what he's doing. And I'm anticipating where he's going, and he's anticipating.
It's from the heart.
Sorry.
It's from the heart. You can't
and also you have to have a training also. Yes. You know, like that's why. And it's not, as I said, it's not such an easy thing to do that crossover thing, because a lot of classical singers, you know, have done it. They can do their rags, and they do very complicated tans and sargams and all that. But when you put them, you know, with a set of chords, how to go through that, they don't necessarily know how to do that. You know?
Most of the musicians today, Indian musicians, they know everything about the rag and the Indian stuff, but they don't know anything.
Okay.
Very few to find people here, especially, who know both the sides.
Okay.
I met in New York this amazing young bansuri player called Jay Gandhi, and he's a disciple of Hariji. And I went to his house because his roommate in Brooklyn, they just moved into this place. His roommate is called Neil. Something, forget this, Neil Murgai. And he's very good sitar player. So, but Neil said, come, and I don't know, Neil plays other stuff. So he said, come to the place and we're going to have a little jam. So there was a acoustic bass player, so we sang some stuff, you know. And then Jai comes in, and I was like shocked, I mean gobsmacked really, because he could play all the Hindustani stuff amazingly. And then came some changes. And he was playing through the changes, like effortlessly, you know. So I mean, that I don't see very often, really. And it's just
something to write, something to do with being Indian. So that I can watch Buddy Guy and I can watch Hindustan in the same kind of high. It just hits you.
And then you can hear Lata Mangeshkar and you think it's funny.
So we are lucky.
Same kind of high from Lata Mangeshkar, I would think.
I never grew up with her, so I can't take to her like her. I grew up with her.
But even then, that high, and what I really hate is the idea she has given of the Indian woman of what her voice should sound like.
Yes.
Yeah, you can't sound like any
singers.
But in the Western world, sopranos are always. I don't know why sopranos are held so
high.
They're
super
high
because they have to be super sexy. That's why. I know, but the.
Whenever in class 8, I asked somebody, I said, why do all the focus in film seem the same way? And then later on, I realized that these two are sisters.
Yeah.
And that's because they were not allowing anybody else to
get
the trade side of it is a different matter.
Yeah.
But look at the impact it has on a young mind. You say, hey, listen, why do all these women sing the same way?
No, but in the end, I think it's a question of conditioning and taste, right?
Yeah.
Because we've been raised on that. I mean, they don't like voices like mine, on the other hand, when I've been living in Europe, and then they say, oh my God, your music, you know, all the women have these screechy, harsh voices. You know, the same thing.
Yeah.
They hate it. You know,
it's
a question of, sorry.
It's changed
today.
Bollywood
is
not like
that.
You know, when you hear Jhumsan, they also say, listen.
And Usha Uttar did not. Oh, yeah.
Because you know, when you listen to Shamshad, they say, this woman is that much older than isn't she so contemporary? Which is why a lot of the songs which they are using now for remixing and all that are Shamshad songs, because Shamshad's voice and you know, why wouldn't you take this?
She was so reviled. Yeah. Everyone was saying, "Ye kya aadmi jaisi aawaz?" When poor Shamshad Begum sang.
But look at the grace she had. But I read one of her last interviews. She gracefully says, she says, you know, ye sare bachche aaya karte the, and harmonium leke Shankar bhi aata tha, you know, Jaikishan bhi aata tha. Maine kabhi Gulab Ghaya saab mere side pe the. Maine kabhi kisi ko nahi kaha. कि मैं खाली हीरोइन के लिए गाऊंगी या अगर मेरे को लेना है तो पूरी पूरी फिल्म मुझे देनी पड़ेगी. देने वाले ये कौन होते हैं? अलग अलग जो करते हैं इन दैट वन आंसर. She so classily dismissed everything that Lata had done after that.
Very nice.
She intended doing that. Please give this woman. She did. And please give this woman a kiss from me because Lata Mangeshkar was my neighbor.
Thank you.
For the Karakura festival. Okay. There's some children's choir and there's other things and there's also Amjad Ali and his sons.
Yes.
And we're closing the thing at 9:20. It's half an hour. 9:20 to 9:50 is my slot. Yes. Okay.
So if we can make it to South Bombay tomorrow, we've got a lovely performance to look forward to. Thank you so very
much.
Thank you.